Time-wise, I'm not going to be strict, but about 45 minutes. When Paul's done his bit, we're going to have a little break, we're going to have the draw, and then I'm going to talk a bit mostly about the forthcoming elections and the AGM on 24th of October. So at this stage, please, I welcome Paul and the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, and good evening. I don't need to keep it to 45 minutes exactly, but roughly, I guess if there's any time wasting, we can increase that time. And so, one thing we don't do a lot of at Exeter, as you know, but I guess we are in a league where that happens a fair bit. And we have had our fair share of experience of teams managing the game, as they now call it, and all the tricks that go on to waste a bit of time. But 45 minutes, roughly, I'm had a long day, actually. This is the second time I've been to the park today. We actually have every month, the first Thursday of every month, we come to St James Park to have our big coaching day with the players. Not that we don't coach the rest of the week, but during the course of each month we have a series of assessments and analytics, and then we put it all together, and then we actually have some sort of synopsis of our play, of our coaching, of all the statistics. We then put it together, we show the players about 20 clips to emphasise or highlight or correct or congratulate them on what they're doing that ties in with how we coach. And then I put a training session on the main pitch. If you've been here at 11 o'clock today, it's been 11 and 1, I did a coaching session. It really was a coaching session, it wasn't a training session. It was literally moving them about like chess pieces to explain where they need to go and try to improve the team. So I've been here already today, this is my second visit, and we look forward, of course, to the game on Saturday against Lake Norwich, because that's going to be, I think, a particularly good game, a particularly good side from what we've seen, and I think we're in decent form, so I'm really looking forward to Saturday.
We've made some lovely new signings this summer, been really impressed, but can you just talk us through how Exeter City scouts new players and what kind of due diligence you do on new players that you want to bring in?
This is the first year in probably three or four we've had the opportunity to make signings like this. I think we have to make sure we don't break from our mould and break from our way of doing things. So, you know, it shouldn't become frivolous. But on the other hand, we've got an opportunity to put a team together that we hope to improve on last year. So, you know, it's been the busiest summer that I've had in three or four years in this respect. I suppose it has to be relevant to us as a club, the way we play, the way we think, the way we act. I think the players we bring in have to suit that. They also, I suppose, it's necessary for them wanting to come to us, because we don't want to twist people's arms to come to us through just finances. But it's of course it's going to be position specific. We need certain players for certain jobs in the team. There has been an element of statistics this summer in terms of looking at the squad in depth, not just the sort of stats you see on Sky Sport for how fast someone's run or how many times they've passed it backwards, but some proper in-depth statistics in terms of the players we've looked at. And then also it comes then of course to the personal side, how I think they'll fit in. But the bottom line will come on whether we can afford it. We still must retain, I think, an element of value for money, and also try to sign players of our norm, which are players who have talent, who have missed out the last couple of years through circumstances. So this year, the signings have been split between one or two players we've specifically gone for, like Bobby Olejnik, for example, we've targeted, and then one or two players who we still think we can get value from in time, like Will Hoskins, have had a very poor couple of years through injury, etc., and we get value for money, and then we see if we can bump them back into form, like we did with Daniel Nardiello, or in the past, for example. So very much split, but it's been a good summer for recruitment in terms of we've had an opportunity this year. I think the test of any signing is in the long term. There's some that look, some will be surprised by, who don't do as well as we think, and there'll be others who do better than we think. So already, you know, Manny Onyeleke has already impressed, I wouldn't say more than we hoped for, but he's, you know, so it's very hard to get the sort of pecking order exactly right with the signing, but I think we've covered the bases reasonably well so far.
I read a lot on social media about either have Tisdale play this young player or I just want to play that one. I don't want to go into specific players, but we all know who we're talking about. And they're probes, if you give them more contact, they're on the fringe. What would interest me to know is, what is the criteria, what is the consideration you make in relation to a young player as to when you're going to play him, or not?
Good question. I actually did an interview on this only 2 days ago about developing young players and when they go into the side, what point. And it's not black and white. It's not at a certain point in the season. It's not... there's opportunity when there's injury. Players have to go in. I can remember Scott Bennett coming in against Tranmere. I think he was a third-year pro at the time. And don't forget, it's also in relation to the size of the squad and the health of the squad. So if I take Scott Bennett as a good example for this, when he started as a professional, he had a very, very strong squad going into League One, and there was no opportunity. There were lots of good players ahead of him. But 2.5 years into his professional career, we had 3 or 4 midfield players all injured on the same week. And he came in and played against Tranmere in a game that he ordinarily wouldn't have been selected for, scored a goal and went on to play over 100 games for us. So there's that type of opportunity that just happens, and it's circumstances. Then there's the opportunity where someone forces the opportunity, when they're so good in training that it's hard not to pick them. Like on the last, 2 years ago, Matt Ryan was looking so good when he joined the professionals that I wanted to find an opportunity to play him. And I decided I was going to play against Wimbledon about 3 or 4 weeks in advance of that for his first game, to play alongside Matt Oakley to ease him in. And it was I sort of engineered that opportunity for him. Then there's the opportunity where it's a combination of things, and it comes down to, I suppose your question is, what's the point you put them in? It comes down to more trust, me and them, the players in them, and it wouldn't be the things that possibly, as a supporter, you would look at, their technique, their ability to beat someone, their technique to... It's more to do their trust within the group, doing the job, thinking correctly, bearing in mind that you know, they'll touch the ball a few times in a game, might be in contact with the ball 2 or 3 minutes out of 90 minutes, the other 87, 88 minutes, do you trust them to do all the things that are necessary? And they gain that, they earn that over time, and they earn that slowly over time in training in the reserves. And the pace of development is very different. One player, Matt Grimes, we never had any particular... I couldn't have told you 2 years ago, before he joined us as a professional, that he would have been that good. We'd seen him play in the youth team, but it wasn't until he joined the professional that he just came to life, he flourished. There are others we've got high hopes for that come into the professionals and take a year or two to sort of gain their confidence. And bizarrely, most of it comes down to the social aspect of being with a group. So take aside the competency, the technical ability, and we sign because they're good enough, technically. And don't forget, I'm also hoping they all get through as well. I could even pick 11 players, and when circumstances are that we've got a small squad, we're thin on the ground, players are going to have opportunity more than, so if you even go back to Dean Moxey and other players in the past, they've played when the team was thin on the ground. Then when we had our rise into League One, we were pushing up League One, very strong squad there, you probably won't remember, but there are a few players that came through at that moment. And that's just down to circumstances. This year we've suddenly got a strong squad again, and it'll be down to the likes of Ollie Watkins or Jamie Reid to force it. And the better the team does, ironically, the better the team plays, the more inclined I will be to play someone like Ollie Watkins. Because the team's really set and doing well, I can put one player in. And that is the beauty of hopefully building a good team where it starts to settle, and I can put one or two of those younger players in, as I've done with Jordan Tilson this year. You know, I put him in against Swindon because I suddenly felt there was some strength in the side around him, and I thought it was a good opportunity, and he's taken his chance with some really good performances. So every player's different, every circumstance is different, but amazingly, it will come down to the social aspect, how they react with their teammates on the bus, in the changing room, all those things are so important, and then, do I trust them? Do I trust them for those 87 minutes, they're not actually touching the ball? As a supporter, you watch the ball. When I watch the game back on Sunday morning, I watch it in slow motion and I watch the space. And that gives me a different view of what they're doing. So they're all different.
I was up.
I saw
that.
Yeah.
Absolutely good turn. I wasn't invited down on the bench.
You should have asked.
Didn't want to say. Paul, can I ask you? I mean, as somebody who clearly espouses playing football, that is not only pleasing to the eye but also effective. How frustrating do you find, and what sort of solution do you feel that there is to play against the teams who clearly come down here? Uncompromising, 9 or 10 players behind the ball. I mean, the second division is pretty uncompromising, with 1 or 2 exceptional sides. You know, can you understand the frustration perhaps of watching a match and seeing 10 players step behind the ball?
Yeah, I think you have to. We have to play as we are and not try to be someone different. So, of course, there's lots of decisions you could make and how to pick a team and what system to pick and do you play with wingers, do you not, etc. But it comes down to being very good at what you do, understanding what you do. I think what is clear, and I don't think I would deny it. I agree with everyone. You know, our home form needs to be better. If you look at our away form over the last 3 years. You tie that into a good home form and we're playoffs, at least. So I think the target this year needs to be a better home form, and we've started reasonably well so far, 2 wins and a draw, 3 games at home. We've invested in the player services again, so we're not hopefully going to be at the loss of the weather and what that brings to the pitch in the winter months. But ultimately, we have to be ourselves. We have to find a way of being good at what we do. And we can't bemoan the fact we play good football and other teams don't, but they then score on the break or they're good at set piece. We can't bemoan it. Everyone's got their own choice to make. I just have to believe, and we've got a chance this year. We've invested, I think, a deeper, high-quality squad, or deeper and more quality than we've had in the past 2 or 3 years. And I think we have to be good at what we do. And the point of analysis is not just to do a list of how many passes someone makes, how many yards they run, but it's actually to work out where do you prioritise your play, where do you prioritise your energy onto the pitch to get maximum value. So it's like a business. It's making sure that we have the right energy at the right place on the pitch at a given time to be efficient. And that takes a bit of time, that takes a bit of work to start, a bit trial and error. So, but we can't bemoan what other teams do. We can't, but I think we do have to, and I have done, start to target the home form. And I think we have to, we can't produce 2 different teams, one for home, one for away. But we have to be good enough at what we do. If you've got the best players, we've got all the best players, but we've got some very good players. I think we have to back ourselves to improve on last year. If you go back 2 years, we've got 54 points. Last year we got 64 points. I'm hoping that this year we keep the same. I do, that's the target. 54 points, 64 points. I'm not saying it was 74, but that's our target. I can't promise that, a mortgage on it, but because the player squad is deeper. It's not necessarily the best players getting better, but it's the mean average of the group. We go back 3 years ago, we lost our promotion challenge when Liam Serkin got injured against Barnet. I think it was 30th of December. Yeah. I think it was 29th of December out here. Then we lost Alan Gow in a training ground game in January. And then Matt Oakley got injured against Gillingham. All in the space of 5 or 6 weeks, those 3 major players all went and we had no backup. And I don't think it's about making the best player better, it's about making the squad better and deeper so you can ride injuries or suspensions, hopefully not too many of them, but we can ride that. So that's really what it comes down to, consistency and not being prone to a dip of form. And I'm hoping to have a sort of a consistent season with better home form.
In terms of league table position, what constitutes success this season?
A promotion challenge. So I think we're in at least playoffs. I think 74 points will get us to the playoffs-ish. don't think that's the target. I would say we are a much stronger unit than we have been, but I also need to say that there's a lot of teams in our league who are stronger than they were last year. Albeit, I think there's been more of a divide this year. I think going back 3 or 4 years, it was very clustered. I wouldn't be surprised this year if the league gets stretched more than it has been. Whether it be 10 very good teams stretched that way and some poor teams that go that way.
I mean, his rise to stardom and the cash we got was incredible, and credit to the team for how it all happened. Looking back now, it was not a coincidence that the style of play that you adopted leading up to Christmas put him almost in the sort of shop window for that elusive transfer window and things. And I know that at the end of season ball, I think you've thanked Matt Oakley and Butters or something about adapting their style of play to put Matt in the shop window. Can you just explain? Because at the time it seemed like, well, there he is and the money were, thank you very much. But credit to you, you obviously adapted your style of play so that he got the right spotlight on him.
Yeah, I think with a business like ours, every once in a while there comes along a golden goose, and I think we saw pretty soon that Matt Grimes was a terrific player in the right team. He could have, he could have had the misfortune of going to another club, I won't name some, in League Two, and he would not have had the opportunity he had with us. One, to play, or secondly, to be given the ball at the right times. So within, I think, 3 or 4 months, go back 2 years, he played against Wimbledon, then he played at Dagenham away, in a particularly poor game, at Dagenham away, second game, and he got left outside, and he learned very quickly what he needed to do to play League Two football. We worked out he was a pretty unique character for a club like ours. So we had in our mind that we thought that at some point he would be a good asset and we should make the most of it, hopefully get 40, 50 games from him. And at some point, a sale would come. So between that point, which was probably that Christmas, 18 months ago, for the following 12 months, Christmas to Christmas, a couple of things happened. One was circumstance, the fact that we entered last season with a very thin squad and embargo, so really we relied on him, and there was no conjecture whether he would play or not, he's in. Whether he was playing poorly or not, he's in. So he suddenly got the opportunity to play regularly, really regularly. That's number one. Number two, I'd already contacted the FA somewhere 6 months previous just to alert them to him. I thought him having an international cap would do very much for his value. Turned out he was one of the best players in the England 20s anyway. But I contacted them and asked them to come and have a look at it. So I made that contact early. That was probably May of that year. And then we came through the embargo, and suddenly, and through circumstances, we suddenly had no central defenders. Danny Coles had left, Pat Baldwin was injured, we had no opportunity to sign anyone else. And I just put the two and two together, the best two players to make Matt Grimes, or bring the best out of Matt Grimes, was Matt Oakley and Danny Butterfield. And I asked them, would they mind changing position for 6 months? And, they had to relinquish certain things. That it was a physical battle for them in terms of the challenge, in terms of what you'd normally expect of a centre defender in League Two. It wasn't the norm. But I thought it offered us the best opportunity for 3 or 4 months to get Matt Grimes at his best. And it probably worked. If you put circumstances in there, you put somehow, I think I used the terminology turkey dress for Christmas, which it very much was. It was about creating an opportunity for Matt to look his best. There aren't too many League Two clubs that would play that way to give him the ball at the right time. But don't forget, within all that, the player needs to be good enough and have the capability to take, not to be 19 and be a good player, but 19 and literally run the team. Albeit, he's given the manager's blessing, or the manager gives the blessing to everyone to give him the ball at the right time, takes them to it. So it's a combination of all those things, but it was a good 12 months lead up. It wasn't just a phone call in January saying we'd like to buy your player, it's done in the day. It's probably 12 months of creating this, and that's what we've got to do with it, because every now and then you'll get an opportunity, we have to maximise it. I think we did a pretty good job right through the club of doing that.
Yeah. Because obviously last year we had two young goalkeepers who were playing, and you mentioned earlier that you've identified a goalkeeper to bring in, and presumably bring him in with the aim of having a number one, but neither of the other two young goalkeepers have gone out. So just wondering kind of how you see that goalkeeping situation, whether you think both the two young goalkeepers, whether their development is still better served being here, even though for one of them there's presumably no way they're going to be playing this season, or whether you think kind of the loan move on the cards, or just kind of how you see that situation really.
Bobby's coming as number one goalkeeper. He's got a very good pedigree, and he comes in, and this was the season we thought this was the time probably to invest in a goalkeeper of that stature. The other two are level pegging. They had a very similar season last year. We've got high hopes for them. And in that respect, we gave them both a two-year extension to their contract. That says everything. We barely do that with a young player. They're both level pegging. James has been on the bench because he's been injured and ill over the past month. At the time, just haven't been available to be on the bench. And both players have been made available for loan at the same time. And if the club comes in for one or t'other, the other will stay, and one will go out and loan for emergency loan. We see them very, very equal over a period of time. There'll be a future for both of them with us. Tie into that, they've both been put out thinking about that on Monday, ran the clubs. Of what we thought was reasonable to go to. We put their details out, and they're both available for loan. And if one comes in for James, Christy will stay for the time being, and vice versa. And when that loan then finishes, we'll swap that over and one can go out. And the whole time, of course, Bobby, he's got the shirt, but it doesn't mean he's going to keep it forever. So we'll see what happens. And I have to say, they both had a very... there'd be a danger they both feel hard done by. Currently, but then they have to realise that they had a wonderful opportunity last year, really. And right from the start, I'd said to them, if I could, I'd bring a senior goalkeeper in, and we couldn't. And they both had a wonderful opportunity. They both played over 20 games last year as teenagers, and they learned a lot from it, and we've got a lot back. So I think at the moment, in terms of their development, they've both done very well. I'm sure this year will somehow enable it to continue.
Probably best directed to Simon Hayward, but I'd be interested in your perspective on it. How important is gaining Academy 2 status? Sorry, Category 2 Academy status.
It's great. Simon would be ideal because he's the one working on it, as is Julian Tack, who's obviously largely...
Yeah, you're the one who potentially sees the ultimate benefit.
Yeah. I think it's hugely important because it raises the standard and expectation of our club, and the whole time this process is, I'm talking nationally, the academy status is progressive. We want to be part of it. It does have financial implications. We have to put money in. The more you put in, the more you get back. So I think it's a case of not missing out and being left behind. I think, but ultimately, Category 2 status means better facility, better coaching, better structure, and you'd like to think, with how we do it, that would ultimately bring players through more and more and continue the process we've already got. But I think it's vitally important we get it, because, and not only on the tangible things like seeing a better pitch or seeing a better change in the room, or seeing, actually, it's how it makes people feel who are working within the business. If you're Simon Hayward and you've been here for 10 years, to know that you're still going forward and you're still putting effort and the club's backing and supporting you to improve is vitally important, because everyone needs to know they're motivated, there's still progress. I mean, that's an intangible part of it, but we need the will to keep turning.
Well, I thought that the team, the young players, got out of the game against Sunderland.
It was an enjoyable experience, Greg. It was a very enjoyable experience. We had 2 days in the northeast. We stayed over after the game, so it was slightly different to go on the day of the game and then stay over and fly back the next day. So it was
like someone did.
Sorry?
Like someone did.
Yeah. So we enjoyed the whole experience. It's good for some of them to see the Premier League setup. You know what it's like behind the scenes. You go through the door and you go in the players' entrance. What it's like at a club like Sunderland compared to, it was different in the boardroom. I went to the boardroom, and it applied right across the board. It's great for all of us to see what goes on behind, and then you see firsthand what it's like, the top players, and I think they had one player that probably made a difference with Jermaine Defoe, and for someone like Jordan Chilton to play against him, or Manny on, yeah, Oyelecki, he had such a good game, Manny, but he lost the ball twice and they scored within 10 seconds of losing the ball. You know, it's cruel, but actually that's what happens. So it's a very good, in a not a pressurised situation, it's really good for some of our younger players to see what it's like. And actually, I think they were torn between thinking this is great, aren't these players great, and actually thinking, actually we're not that far away from these ourselves. And the difference is, I mean, Jermaine Defoe was a difference on the night, he was fantastic. But there were other players, there was a bizarre moment, and the players were laughing about it at half time. So we come in at half time, it's 3-3, and none of us could quite believe it's 3-3. At least a little bit. And I didn't quite know, you know, which way, where do we go from here? I wasn't planning this. So it's a cavernous dressing room. I mean, literally, I mean, it probably fit into this room here. There's different sections, but it's huge. So I walked around the corner to wash my hands, and there were two of our players having a whip in the urinals. I could hear the conversation, and they were talking about a moment at 3-3, just before Sunderland kicked off. We've just scored our third goal, and it's gone to 3-3. So the Sunderland players are having a bit of a argy-bargy, blaming each other, and this, that, and the other. And our players are waiting for the kickoff. And there's two of our players stood near the D, and that, now they're stood at the urinals having a chat. This is at half-time. And one says to the other, I think I'm as good as them. And the other player said, me too. And it was just a very strange moment. The rest of it, in fact, they were sort of surprised by it. It was a lovely moment. I wish I could have videoed it quite quickly. It was a really strange moment. So I think they were torn between being enjoying it, thinking it was great, and this is where I want to get to, and also being a bit disappointed that actually we weren't that far away. I think we ran out of steam. We had a really good chance with Lee Holmes and a header over the crossbar 3-3, which I mean, that had gone in. God only knows what would have happened in terms of them and us. And we just ran out of steam. To concede two late goals was a disappointment. 6-3 didn't do us justice. But it was a really good adventure, really. I suppose we earned it with the win at Swindon. So we earned that opportunity. So maybe they'll recognise that and do it again sometime.
The fact that we played an extra game and tied us, but you didn't think that was an excuse, which is critical. But do you think an extra factor in that was the come down from the adrenaline of the Sunderland game? Not just the fact it was an extra game, but the fact that it was such a big game for a lot of our players.
I think there was fatigue right across the board. I mean, I actually, in readiness for the Wimbledon game, I probably put more effort into the preparation than I would do normally. I did the opposite. Rather than going all smooth and comfortable, I actually got a little bit spiky with them, and I pushed them, and we put a lot more prep in than we normally do. I think there was a lethargy about the way we played, not helped by a brutal opposition and a referee that didn't give us a lot of support. But as I made the point after the game, you know, the season's going to be... And actually, I do actually remember, I got an email from one of the supporters on by Mike Radford on Thursday, congratulated us on the performance at Sunderland and what a good team we had. I said, well, the test will be on Saturday at Wimbledon. And because I knew what would come, I knew the brutality of the way they played, not nasty, but just the way they played. I knew that it was going to be a big change in environment for us and the way the game was played. But I think we had a fatigue about us. And I don't think it was a surprise that Ryan Harley was probably our best player and he hadn't played on Tuesday, for example. So you've got to be careful when you give players the excuse. They think, you know, you have to push them. And I didn't. And I made the point that they looked tired. I made the point that the referee gave them little support. But I didn't say, you know, we're going to have to be better. Cut long story short, we could have played that way and still got a draw if we had conceded a poor goal from the long throw. So you've got to be careful that you're not too soft with them. But they also have to know you're realistic. And they were tired. And it was, again, too much for us. But I still wanted to come away with a draw, and I was really cross that they didn't manage it.
Good or bad? Has that had any impact on you yourself this year?
This year, no. We've had no impact at all. But other months, August or the January, we've had a terrible time. You know, be it last minute signs, where you really get left. in a quadruple to do. And I don't envy at all the sort of West Brom and their players who have played for the club again. I can just see it all happen. I can understand why it happened. I don't say it's right, but I can just, it builds up into this crescendo, and it must be very difficult. This year, no, we tend to be a team that we receive the phone call rather than we make it. We had no phone call for our players this year. This August, it may be different in January. And other Januaries have been very different. I don't particularly think it's great. I don't think it helps much. It puts agents into a position of real power. They can lever and engineer things, and it's not great. But that's the way. It's not the way we work. I actually saw a table today, slightly off the subject, about continuity in League Two clubs. One of our statistics has come through, and they looked at the first five games, the players that played in the 2014 League Two, and what they call it the turnover table. So who's had the most players who stayed at the club? So the top three clubs so far in League Two, 75%-ish of players, Bristol Rovers, Barnet. Two teams to cover that, which is no surprise there, and Exeter. So in terms of continuity, again, we're in that top bracket. At the very bottom, there's a team on 20%, 22%, 25%. So again, we've got continuity, and we prefer not to have too much chopping and changing. Because you get that with chopping and changing, you either get Notts County, where it can all go wrong, potentially, Yeovil, two relegated, or you get Notts County, Leighton Orient, that can suddenly spark something off. But I'd rather not be in that bracket where you chuck it up in the air and toss it a coin. So it's
one final question. Martin.
Can you just say what it means to you to re-sign players that you've had before? I think people like Ryan, David Noble. Is that an easy decision for you?
If we've got a spot for them, yes. There's the odd player where you want to find a spot for them, like Ryan. I mean, that was I couldn't really say no to that one. When I had the opportunity last Christmas time, he was such a talisman for us, and now he's getting his form again. I think it means a lot because they want to come back. Not necessarily on a personal level for me, but they want to come back to the club. They know they've had good days. And there's so many players who have come to us needing us. I think I've heard someone call us the rehab club. Within the game of football, the rehab club, and other terms. But basically, they mean we're a club that certain players need at certain times of their career. We've had a lot that have come to us, and we've given them a really good leg up. And there are lots who then need us again. And there are other players, I'm sure, there have been others that have knocked on the door we can't bring back. But more like Ryan, it was not a no-brainer because you have to consider everything. But you can see now he's finding his form. He was off the pace when he came back to us because he hadn't played for quite a long time. But he's finding his feet again. But it's a very nice endorsement of the club, how we do things, and football's a very fractious environment. The players, you can't pick more than 11 players. There's always a young player wants to play, and there's all the senior players beginning to get too old, and there's players in the middle who want to move. The whole thing is very fractious. So to know that even during those times, someone spent 2 or 3 years with us, they've been part of things they don't like. And I've ups and downs with Ryan before, or David Noble. I've had my ups and downs with all of them. But they want to come back, and we're probably the best club for them, and I think there'll be others. Not we can take them all. Probably, we can't, but it's a nice endorsement of what we do as a the part of the country we work in, you know, the supporters, the stadium, everything. It's a really good endorsement.
When Ryan left, clearly things didn't quite work out for him as he would have expected. He's come back now and finding his form again. Do you take credit for that?
For coming back?
Well, take credit for the fact that he seemed to have lost his form when he left. And now coming back, he seems to have now found glimpses of the player that we had.
Yeah, well, it's nice. You have to remember what people can do. It's the same talk of the youth team player, then losing their way when they come into our professional life. Exactly the same. And the conversation we had with it internally last week was, don't forget what they can do when they're 18. Just because they're now 19, 20, and they've lost their confidence, try to remember what they did at 18, and just give them time. And the social dynamic is so important for those players. But for someone like Ryan, it's about continuity of playing football. So, a bit like George Friend, he may have moved to a big club just as they were getting promoted to the Premiership. And sometimes, if you were Brendan Rodgers or you were Mick McCarthy, you signed up a player from League Two and then you're going to the Premiership, the stakes are so high to then take a chance on them. But I can see why he missed out at Swansea. Not knowing the detail, but I can see how that would happen. And then I think he's just had two or three years where he's just lost his rhythm, lost playing every week. And, you know, the only credit we take is for saying we still think he can do it, and because he's now 13, not 26, whatever it is. But he plays, there you are. You have to put up with the first couple of months where they're off it a bit. I mean, he was off it when he arrived. He wasn't, he had his legs about him. And then he suddenly got, I think the first glimpse we had was Carlisle away, when he scored two goals. Ryan is about, his game is about running. People all associate him with the silky skills and everything else. His game is about energy and running. And most top footballers, it starts with some sort of physicality. But Ryan can run, and he can cover air. And when he's running, you know he's fit, because there's that ability then to do something with the ball. When you're anaerobic, when you're completely out of breath, and your heartbeat's at 180, to still have some power to do something. And he's got that backhand, so we need to keep him there. So the credit, I suppose, we take is by recognising what we saw before and trusting it. And it's amazing what trust does to you. If you're trusted and you're respected, whatever you do, it's amazing how much that can add to you. And Ryan, I think, is a good example.
Okay. Paul, thank you very much for coming. I appreciate it. A very busy schedule at the moment. What we're going to do now is we're going to have the draw. We're going to have a break for 10 or 15 minutes. Hopefully there's some food left. Please use the bar. Elaine's then going to say a few words, and I'm going to talk a bit about the trust. But if I could just ask you to please show...